और ब्रो सार्थक, मार्स में क्या हालचाल?
कुछ नहीं, बच्चे यहाँ इलोन पापा के पार्क में खेल रहे हैं।
ओह इलोन पापा, नाइस।
तुम्हारे पीछे क्या हो रहा है?
ये अरे ये तो एंड्रॉइड से इनका रोज का चलते ही रहता है। आओ आओ मार लो मुझे भी आज ही। अरे तुझे वो दिन याद है जब 2021 में हमने एक पॉडकास्ट किया था, जब हम कहते थे कि टाइम ट्रैवल पॉसिबल ही नहीं होगा।
वो भी क्या दिन थे। सो हेलो एवरीवन, टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू शूट दिस पॉडकास्ट विथ प्रोफेसर शंकर नारायणन, ऑल्सो नोन एज प्रोफेसर शैंकी फ्रॉम द फिजिक्स डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ आईआईटी बॉम्बे। एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस वेरी मैनी डिफरेंट थिंग्स सच एज कॉस्मोलॉजी, डार्क मैटर, डार्क एनर्जी, टाइम ट्रैवल, द लिमिटेशंस ऑफ फिजिक्स, अर्ली यूनिवर्स, एक्सेट्रा एक्सेट्रा एक्सेट्रा। सो लेट्स स्टार्ट। हेलो सर, वील डायरेक्टली स्टार्ट विद द पॉडकास्ट। Our first question to you is, right from our childhood, we have been thinking that we've known that Big Bang theory is like the most accepted, and it is the theory that we consider to be the origin of the universe. But I'm sure that it has some of discrepancies, and like we have to a certain level compromised to accept that Big Bang is the truth. So, is there any scope for improvement, and why is it that it is such a widely accepted theory?
So let me now, Karthik's question, I'll put it into three different ways, three different baskets to be called. So why Big Bang theory is considered to be the correct theory of describing the universe? And the second thing is, what are the problems which it's facing currently? And what are the things which people are trying to see to overcome those difficulties? So I will put these questions in three different ways. So to answer this, first let us ask the question, what is the most thing which, whether a thing which it can answer, there is one thing which we see every day in everyday life. Okay, so this is what we actually see in everyday life. Yeah. So basically in the day, your sky looks very nice. And in the night, this is from Chile, this is a ESO in the Chile, it looks like this. Of course, in Bombay, you don't see this at all, but this is how it looks. Okay, so Olbers, in 1823, he actually posed an interesting question, and for which there was not an answer for almost 100 years. So the question which he asked is that why the night sky should be uniformly bright, and why that is something which is, he said that the night sky should be uniformly bright, but then there was no real answer to this. Okay, so this, because it goes back to the question which, that Olbers made two assumptions to it, which is what people thought about, because the universe, when we look at the sky, it looks all looks very static, and people thought that it was there indefinite, of course, indefinite to the human life and the human civilization, but it was existing even before. Mm-hmm. Right? So basically, he made these two assumptions, and then his consequence was that this is what his consequence was, and this is the video, the snapshot. If you assume what Olbers assumed, your night sky actually should be like this.
Oh yeah,
should be actually very bright.
Yeah.
Okay, so this was a call, that is where it was called an Olbers paradox for almost 100 years.
Yeah.
Okay. So the Olbers paradox can be sorted out very simple way. If you make one assumption saying that our universe was not infinite but it was expanding, then what happens automatically, that the expansion automatically tells you that the universe has to be finite, because if it is expanding, if you go back in time, if you take a snapshot and go back, reverse the clock, then at some point, it should have been contracted. It should have been contracted even more, even more, even more. Then it should have started with a small region. Okay. Yeah. So this answers immediately Olbers paradox, and it was sorted out immediately. Fine. So then the question came in is that, okay, what are the, so science is not just answering some paradoxes, but it also has to make some testable predictions, for instance. So one of the important predictions of what we call it as Big Bang or SRW, or a standard model of cosmology, Friedman-Robertson-Walker, Lemaitre-Walker model of cosmology, is that it makes a prediction that there should be residual photons or electromagnetic radiation, which should be present, and this should be observable in some radio band. Okay, so it is what is called the cosmic microwave background radiation, which we see. And that is basically what we actually see now. And that is one of the fantastic success of the standard model of cosmology or the Big Bang model. The second one, which is also important, is that, okay, so we see that, but if you go back in time, then the universe was very hot. So what you should have had is basically some electrons, protons, and things like that. Okay, it didn't have anything beyond that. So then how did we have all these structures, which now we see all elements, many elements are there. So how did these elements form? Okay, when was this element formed? How did they form? And that also was Big Bang could explain what is now called, referred to as a nucleosynthesis, Big Bang nucleosynthesis. So it explains starting from electrons and protons at different energy levels, how hydrogen was formed, then how helium, then lithium, and several other elements, light elements I'm talking about, they are all formed at different epochs in the early universe. And then it, okay, so this is basically where lot of the success happened till 1970s, 80s, very, very highly successful model of Big Bang actually worked. Now, but there was again a problem of, so it was able to explain all this, but it couldn't explain a basic concept like how these galaxies, the galaxies which we see and the solar system like what we have, how did they actually form? What was the cause of it? So that was never, Big Bang can never actually answer. So what it actually assumes is that if there is a small seed perturbation, what it's called some seed perturbation, then these seed perturbations can accumulate because of gravitational attraction. Because if the only thing gravity does is keeps attracting. It never has a repulsive effect. So it basically keeps attracting. So what happens is if you have a seed perturbation, what they call it a seed perturbation, seed density, it's a small difference in the density in some region. If there is a small blob of matter here, then the matter around it will start accumulating because this has more gravitational force, it will keep attracting. Fine. So the question was, if you have a seed density field, for instance, seed density, you see, then the standard model could explain, a standard model of cosmology could explain how these large-scale structures are formed. But it could not explain what was the origin of, what is the causal mechanism. We always are looking for causal mechanism because we know that the physics works on causal physics. There is nothing acausal about it. So if you have a causal mechanism, then you should be able to explain what is the reason, how did the seed field, what they call it, a seed density perturbation form. Of course, that cannot be explained within a standard model. So that's where this is there is something called cosmological inflation, which we still don't know whether it is, we know that it is, seems to be the correct theory, but we don't know whether it is the model. So if you include inflation with the standard model of cosmology, then it is a highly successful model. Fine.
Okay.
So this was highly successful up to 1995, 1997. After this, things were going fine. We thought that many things we have understood it. But then this supernova data came up in 1997, where there is two groups which showed that if you have to explain the supernova data, then we have to not be just, we should have an extra matter or the extra new energy, which is called dark energy, which has to explain that. Otherwise, the standard model cannot explain. Fine. So now the aim is to understand what is this dark energy is, because it is constituting almost 60% of the universe's energy. And 63, let's take it. Then there is another 22% of dark matter. So we have 95% of matter, total energy content of the universe, which we don't have any understanding. 5% is basically what the baryons, or what we are made up of, like basically electrons, neutrons, protons, they're all made up of, and photons, of course. So these constitute like roughly 5%. I'm just giving you numbers like this. So of course, so these are the problems which we face. But what we are trying to say is that we seem to have a fairly good understanding of several epochs in the universe. And the standard model is able to explain most of them, right? So the question is, yes, so definitely the standard model requires exotic fields. So for instance, we have to have this dark energy, which is an exotic field. The reason why it is exotic is because it requires the dark energy requires something like a pressure, which is negative. It cannot have a positive pressure. Okay. So for instance, if you look at a gas, a cylinder with a gas, and I keep pushing the piston down, I know that the pressure of the gas increases inside because the velocity pushes it, and then it tries to, more velocity is happening, and then there is basically, it seems to increase the pressure. But here, if I keep compressing it, it is going to opposite effect. Basically, it will be opposite. Okay. So this is something which we cannot envisage actually right now, what is this dark energy? So there is a lot of effort in understanding this. What is this dark energy? But there is an alternative which people have been thinking about, which is I think also quite possible. So that goes back to the theory of gravity. So the Big Bang rests on something called what is the theory of gravity which we want to use. The theory of gravity is the general Einstein's general theory of relativity. Mm-hmm. Now, Einstein's general theory of relativity is tested very well in the solar system case, like what we know anything. For instance, GPS is one of the classic examples of general relativity, because without GPS, without general relativity, GPS will not work. So we know how GPS how general relativity is successful in solar system scale. Okay, but we don't know whether it is the correct theory in a larger scale. So in the sense, cosmological distances. So the distances we are talking about is gigaparsec scale. Okay, one parsec is 10 power 18. Mm-hmm. So we are talking about something like megaparsec is 10 power 24, and the other one is 10 power 27. So we are looking at distance scales which are 10 power 27 compared to the solar system scales which are very small. So we don't know whether the theory of gravity, the Einstein theory, is a correct description at the largest possible scale. So people are even wondering about that. In the sense, there have been a lot of effort to look at if GR is not the general relativity is not the correct theory of gravity, then what is the correct theory of gravity? Okay, so that is a lot of effort which is going on, people have been working on trying to see how to make predictions. So finally, you come up with a theory. For instance, let's say you have a theory, but you have to now ask the following question: how do we distinguish this theory from the standard general theory of relativity? And to make testable predictions. And many of these are very sensitive things because these are very small effects which we have to worry about. So the instruments have to be highly sensitive. And it cannot be done in the next few years. It can happen in the next decade or in the next 15 years. That's what we are all hoping for. In the next 10 years or so, there will be a lot of effort to basically figure it out. Whether it is really the dark energy which is driving the universe, or it is the modification to GR, general relativity, which is actually driving the universe. So those kind of issues which we are still trying to address.
Okay.
I hope this long answer is fine.
So you touched upon a concept that is very exotic, very new to us as well, that is dark matter or dark energy. So there's this theory that I read, and it meant that dark energy is nothing, or dark matter is nothing, but it is modified gravity only. So I just want you to explain that in simpler terms so that everyone can understand what modified gravity is.
Okay, so there are two things to this. So dark matter and dark energy are two different entities. Yeah. They are not the same entity. So dark matter is supposed to be behaves like a matter. Okay, it has almost a negligible pressure. In the sense, I only go and hit it, and then only I know that there is a dark matter. It's like a blob.
Okay.
This blob of matter will not exert any force on this particle. If there are two particles, they will not exert force. They, only if they come and hit each other, then the particle will experience another force. Particle will have a pressure. So usually we call it as the, these are called what is called the pressureless dust. Basically they are, they only experience pressure. You only see the pressure only when they come and hit each other. So basically you can always assume it to be zero. Okay. Okay. So there is one thing which is important, which is always something when we do all these between cosmology and then when we do gravity, especially, and with respect to any other physics. When gravity takes over, all other forces actually become irrelevant. Their properties, their small scale properties are all very irrelevant because the gravity is only acts upon in the largest possible scale. And in the case of gravity, gravity is very democratic. It doesn't care whether it is charges or it is not charges. It is highly democratic. It only treats everything with mass or energy, and that's how it treats. So we can when we do in the largest possible scales, we can always assume that these pressure, this dark matter, we always approximate it to be a pressure to be equal to zero. Okay, but that is not the case with dark energy. Dark energy has a negative pressure.
Okay.
So there are two different concepts altogether. There are two different concepts, and dark matter was known to exist by Zwicky was the first person to propose it because of the what he found is that in many of the galaxies the light curve, what they call it as a light curve, it doesn't go away, it didn't decay as was what is expected, and hence he proposed this to be this. I'm trying to. 1 minute.
I'll
just see whether I have
this
slide.
Yeah, sure.
So this is basically this is a plot of what is called the rotational velocity on the y-axis, and the x-axis is basically distance from the center. Right. Now, so what they did is this is what, so there are two curves here. One is the blue curve and one is the red curve. The blue curve is basically what is measured, which is the rotational velocity. So basically you see all these stars going around the galaxies, and you measure from there, you can measure their rotational velocity because you can do that.
Yeah.
Now you measure it, and this is what is the measured one. Now what you can do is we know the Kepler's laws are very good. So you calculate using the Kepler's law, what should be the mass corresponding to this velocity, and you can calculate this, what should be the calculated one. Now, this is what is the calculated rotational velocity, assuming that this is a mass, because if you only see these masses, which you see are the light and the corresponding stars and things like that, which is what we call it as baryon. And you see this, and this is what is the calculated. So you calculate, this is what you actually calculate, but this is what is measured. So, but then the measurement is supposed to be correct, right? So, because it has been measured by very high sensitivity. So that basically tells us there is a missing mass, which you are not able to see. Our naked eye is not able to see, or the telescopes are not able to see. So this is what is referred to as a dark matter. And this is by the simple Newtonian relation, which is basically given by V squared is equal to GM by R. Okay. So what I understand from your question is that there have been attempts to say that maybe this dark matter itself is not there. So there is an alternative theory, which is called MOND, which is called Modified Newtonian Dynamics. Which has been proposed by Milgram in 1980s, late 80s, and he showed that if you use this, then it is possible to, there is a parameter in that, if you fine tune that parameter, then that parameter, you don't need an extra dark matter for it, then you will automatically, it can actually fit with the measured data. Now, the problem with this is that the modified Newtonian dynamics is not very good because the same parameter, for instance, if this parameter is good to fit this, it cannot explain many other things which you need to explain in the cosmological scale, because this is in still very small scale, that is you cannot explain it in this. So there has been a lot of problem with the MOND itself. So MOND is one of the theories which replaces dark matter, which is supposed to replace dark matter, but it has other problems. And still now, dark matter seems to be the best bet to explain many of the features, including structure formation, the large-scale structure. Now, the other aspect is the dark energy. So, the dark energy is is a different ball game altogether, because it has very strange feature. As I mentioned, pressure is negative.
Yeah.
Okay. So we always have seen all matters which we see in the terrestrial, this thing, all either it is pressure is zero or very small, or pressure is always positive. We have never experienced anything where pressure is negative. Okay, and this negative pressure is the one which is causing the universe to accelerate currently. We are in the accelerating
phase. Yeah.
Okay, so that is what I meant, that for this also there are modifications to gravity which people have been trying to. So there are two sets of modifications one is trying to do. One is modifications to the dark matter, so that you don't need a dark matter at all. But you want to have other forms of modification. That is what is called MON. But there is dark energy, which is happening in the largest possible scale. Okay? Dark energy is the one which is supposed to be like, I don't want to call the word ether, but it is like, it is omnipresent in the largest possible
scale. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so these are two different modifications to gravity we are looking for. These are not the same modifications. But modifications to gravity in the largest possible scale is something which people have been seriously considering in the last 10 years or so. People have been seriously working on, because as we see, we don't appreciate negative pressure. We don't even know what is negative pressure means. Yeah, we only know what is working. So there is, but we accept it for the present and we are going ahead with it. But there is a lot of, but we know in field theory, you can have negative pressure. Quantum field theory predicts there can have negative pressure, which is one of the predictions is called the Casimir effect, where if you have a two parallel plates, like a capacitor, and it shows that at some point, if you keep close enough, and if it is in vacuum, for instance, then these two parallel plates come together. They attract each other. It's called a Casimir effect. So this might look exotic right now, but it actually has a very interesting implication. For instance, if you want to make nano gadgets, now you have to make, for instance, if you want to make nano machines, and the size of these machines are going to be nanoscale, right? Or the 10^-8. So now what is going to happen is that you are going to make a machine. So for instance, let us take a case, you want to make a nano watch and you have to have a gear. Right now, the two, in the case of the usual in the usual clock, these gears are going to be touching each other, right?
Yeah,
and they have to move each other. Okay, now, and this is all in centimeters and tens of centimeters, because we are having big machines, the clock. Now, we are going to nanoscale. Now, when you go to nanoscale, these effects are actually very prominent. So, people have been trying to study these Casimir effects so this has to be avoided, because what is going to happen is that if you make a machine, nano machine, what is going to happen is that this Casimir effect pressure will make the machine join together and it will not move. Basically, it will be just broken.
So
you have to avoid this Casimir effect. So people have actually noticed this Casimir effect. It is not just a fictitious effect. It is actually an effect which is name known, and people are trying to remove it. So now the problem is to, if you want to make the machine run in a nanoscale, then you have to remove this Casimir effect. Okay. So although you know it in the field theory, quantum field theory predicts that, and we know that now it has to be, this is one of the features in nanoscale, because these nano machines will show this Casimir effect of negative pressure, so that people are trying to remove it. The question is whether it will work in the largest possible scale. That we don't know. So that's where we are looking for alternatives.
Okay. Yeah. That answered my question properly. And So moving on from the origin of universe and dark matter and dark energy discussion. The next question I want to ask is, we have heard the folklore of Arabian Nights, and where some protagonist gets a genie and three wishes. So assuming if people in this world get a genie and he grants them three wishes, so I'm damn sure that almost every one of them would have one wish, that is to travel in time. So could science be the genie for us? Like, could science be that genie who can fulfill our wish to travel in time?
Yeah, what do you mean by time travel? So these are the two. See, this is the folklore which is there in this thing. What do you mean by time travel? So you want to go back in time. That is what you mean by time travel.
I mean, in general, the time axis is just open to us.
Yeah. So the way we okay. So there are several. So the physics basically rests on the fact that the time axis, although the equations of physics are invariant with respect to time, the sense it doesn't care whether time is going forward or time is going backward. Okay, but the symmetry, the universe which we are living is not symmetrical, and the outcome of these laws also do not possess the same. So the problem is not with the physics. It is basically the outcomes which we have. See, there are two things which just has to be understood. So the laws which we have, that is the physics laws which we are talking about, at the level of it is very simple, right? Because it says energy conservation, it is momentum conservation.
Yeah.
Now, if you go ahead, it will show you that there should be other conservation, charge conservation. There are other conservation which is there. Now, these are a very small number of laws, and they are symmetrical. In the sense, they don't worry about anything, right? But the outcomes which we have, which is enormous kind of outcomes which we have, and these outcomes do not possess the same symmetry. See, there are two differences which we are having. One is the laws of physics, which are very simple, and they are relatively simple to understand. But the complexity which comes out is basically enormous that we don't have understanding of.
So by outcome, do you mean that everything that is in reality?
Correct. Yes. Whatever we see is a complex structure, right? We don't see anything simple. Okay.
Yeah.
So there is a famous physicist who passed away recently. His name is Anderson. He was also the Nobel laureate. So he was he basically had a hierarchy of a system, basically math. Then mass dictates how the particles have to behave. The simple particles, okay? But then the simple particles, basically electrons, protons, make things very complicated, right? So they make atoms, and these atoms can be many different types of atoms we have, very, very different materials we can generate. So that is our next set of hierarchy. But these are very complex. Now, these complex systems itself can make very complicated biological molecules, right? That is another set of complexity. So the question which I think is always missed out in the general public is, the laws are simple. Laws are invariant with respect to time, but the outcomes are the things which are coming out, they are not symmetrical. So hence, we are living in a universe which is asymmetrical. Okay, so this is always a confusion which happens, because if you remember, many people say that the equation laws of physics are actually symmetrical. So what is the issue?
Yeah.
Okay, so that jump is always there. Because that is something which we can work with, and we know what are the limitations of the laws beyond a point at some point, but. But the outcomes, which is where you should always look at, and that is actually a nice way of putting it. He had an hierarchy actually. This is the 1973 or something, which where he wrote this. It's a 2-page or 3-page paper. It's quite nice. There's nothing, no equations, but you can see it.
Okay.
So he basically lists down the hierarchy. So once the things become complex, then we don't know. So for instance, the biological systems make it complex. Now each of these biological systems have its huge social environment will also introduce also psychological environment, which is also different. And then we have a society which is even more complex. Okay. So there is a hierarchy of asymmetry which is generated from, if you go from one to another. And at every point, it's the complexity which has been introduced. So you can ask the same question, right? These are each of these atoms, for instance, carbon, lithium, carbon, everything. They're all made up of electrons, protons, and neutrons. But they are all very different people. Okay, they all follow the same. They are all made up of three, right? But but they all look very, the properties are very different.
Yeah.
So what makes them different? Okay, so that is a very, very tough question to answer, even now. If you think about it, they are all made up of three. There's nothing different with them, but their behavior, the structure, everything, the properties, everything is very different. So now you make a molecule, that makes it even more. Then you make biological molecules, that makes it even more. Then you have species, and species have their own complexity. So all these are, so you go from simplest, so mathematics is simple, okay? It's not simple in the sense of simple, but what I'm saying is, we know that these are the, we know that the law, these are theorems which can work out. Right? You then start into physics, then it becomes even more complex. Simple may have this thing. Then it becomes even more complex. So the question is, this time travel thing is although there is the physical, simple physical materials can, the particles will not have any problem. When you make complexities, we don't know what is in the real life. So I have given you an answer which is a roundabout.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. But we have understood that.
But like in general, you mean that it is good theoretically, but in reality, it is very difficult.
No. Theoretically, it's correct. Because the thing is, the physics works in all scales. But the question is, every time when we do this thing, but there is a certain other level of complexity which has to come in.
Yeah.
Fine. So for instance, when we do hydrogen atom, we have to only worry about the electron proton interaction, which is quite nice. This is simple to understand.
Yeah.
But when we have many of the other particles, then other complexity comes in. We have to, it comes up with new features. Everything comes up with new features.
Yeah.
And this is an asymmetrical, that is what I call it as asymmetrical, because that is a new feature which you are actually coming up with. And we cannot ab initio know that this is going to happen. See, the thing is that if I have, why should helium to be inert? But the point is that there are several other features which we don't understand. So we have to really test it.
Yeah.
So what I'm trying to tell is that the laws of physics are very simple, and it defines a symmetrical universe. But if I have a symmetrical universe, nothing is going to happen exciting. You need to have a symmetrical universe to get a lot of other interesting features.
But
we try to explain it in a much very simple way. Okay. So that's where, if you look at it, many of the physics problems have to be now gone into computational level, because it is so complex to do anything with pen and paper. We have to do everything in computational level. But then things get, you understand many of the features.